So without further ado, Brian Donohue from Red Canary.
First off, thank you, Adam. Thank you to the ATT&CK team for organizing this conference and for allowing me to come and speak at it. Apologies in advance if my talk gets interrupted by any dogs barking or the pitter-patter of toddlers running flat-footed above my head, but such is the reality of life in 2020. So without wasting any more time, my talk is starting over with sub-techniques, and it's about the lessons that we learned at Red Canary when we remapped from the old pre-sub-techniques version of MITRE ATT&CK to the new sub-techniques version of ATT&CK. So before I go any further, a few things about myself. I work at Red Canary. I primarily either support publication of content or work on it myself. Importantly, in the context of this talk, I am one of the lead writers of our threat detection report, which is an effort to gather all of the threats we detect in our customers' environments and sort of rank and stack the MITRE ATT&CK techniques associated with them for the purposes of determining which ATT&CK techniques are most prevalent and creating a ranking order to them. Prior to joining Red Canary, I've worked as a journalist and as a CTI analyst. About 10 years ago now, I was interviewing for a job as a social media editor at ThreatPost. It would have been my first job. It was my first job. The editors there asked me, had I any experience with social media? I lied. I told them I did, when in fact I did not. They either believed me or didn't care, but they hired me. And that's how my career started here. So if you dislike me or my talk, you can send your hate mail to Paul Roberts and or Dennis Fisher. Now that I've got that out of the way. So we've already gone through who I am. I'm gonna give you guys just an absolute bare minimum background on what Red Canary does so that you can sort of understand the context around our remapping effort. Then we'll run through the seven lessons we learned, and then we'll close with a minute or two of question and answers. So one of the primary things Red Canary does is manage detection and response. So we gather telemetry from our customers' endpoints. We parse that telemetry against some thousand of detection analytics to surface potential threats. Then those potential threats are reviewed by a human on our detection engineering team. That detection engineer can either suppress or hide that event, or they can confirm that it's a threat, in which case they ship what we call a confirmed threat detection to a customer. For the purposes of this talk, that's effectively a customer notification. It's more than that, but for our purposes, just understand that it includes, among many other things, the MITRE ATT&CK techniques that threat is corresponded with. So given the way our system operates, we have a few different options for how we can handle ATT&CK mapping. We can do it at the behavioral analytic or the detector level. The benefit of doing it at that level is that it's highly scalable. You get to make your mapping decisions when you write your detection analytic. So you make that decision once and it's automated from there on out. The problem with that is that it's bad at nuance. So you might have a theory about what your detection analytic is going to catch, and then in practice, it might catch something altogether different. A second option would be to do this at the detection level. So if we go back that last slide, the detection level would be at this human analysis level. The benefit of doing it at the human analysis level is that it is good at nuance, right? You've got all of the context you need to make a determination about what you are, what MITRE ATT&CK technique is associated with it. However, it's difficult to scale because it slows down your detection pipeline because you have to make a decision and choose from 200 some odd techniques every time you detect a threat. The third potential option is the why not both option. And I'm actually going to get into that later on in this presentation. So we actually map at the analytic level. So we make the determinations about what our analytics, what technique they should map to, when we're developing them. And the reason we do this is because primarily Red Canary exists to detect threats. So when we adopted MITRE ATT&CK a few years ago, we made the decision to optimize for threat detection and speed since oftentimes we're detecting things of high priority rather than being 100% accurate in our mapping all the time. So what this looks like in practice, the red text at the top here is a detection analytic. It basically is looking for a process that is an L test. And that also includes a command line with domain trust or all trust. This maps to domain trust discovery. And it's basically a technique that adversaries use to make determinations about domain trusts within an environment. This is irrelevant for the purposes of this talk, but historically this detector has helped us catch a whole lot of trickbot activity. So now that you understand sort of this high level background, the first lesson that I'd like to impart onto you is, like, if you're going to map things, or if you're going to transition from old MITRE to sub techniques, like, the first thing you need to figure out is all of the things that you were mapping to MITRE ATT&CK in the first place. So for our purposes, that would include behavioral detection analytics, which I already sort of explained. It would also include atomic red team tests. So atomic red team is an open source adversary simulation platform that we manage and maintain. And all of the tests in it are designed to simulate attack techniques, and they're mapped to attack techniques. For the purposes of this talk, you can kind of think of these two things, the behavioral analytics and the atomic tests, sort of interchangeably, because, like, the atomic tests are isolated scripts that map to attack and simulate behaviors. The analytics are isolated bits of Ruby code, also mapped to attack, designed to catch techniques. We also map a lot of our research and educational content to MITRE ATT&CK, but, like, a lot of it is derivative of our detection. And we didn't go back and retroactively map any of it, so that didn't really involve any upfront work. For your purposes, you might be mapping threat intelligence reporting to MITRE ATT&CK. You might have, like, charts and tables that you're using to determine things like detection coverage, or, like, any variety of security controls, alerts, IOCs, and the like. Having some issues here. Once you figure out what you need to map to attack, it's time to do the actual mapping. Sorry, I'm having a little bit of trouble controlling the screen right now. All right, there we go. So first things first, well, I guess it's the second thing. So let the code do the work for you, okay? So luckily, MITRE ATT&CK created a useful little JSON crosswalk script. And effectively what that'll tell you is, like, it'll tell you, like, what a technique remaps to. So maybe a technique becomes a parent technique and it'll tell you the sub-techniques under it. Maybe a technique becomes a sub-technique and it'll tell you the parent technique above it, or possibly the technique, if it's like scripting, has just deprecated. So we took that JSON crosswalk script, we built a little PowerShell script that sort of helped it work specifically with our environment. And, like, for Atomic Red Team, we kind of naively thought that the code would do all the work for us. We were quickly disabused of that notion. For the behavioral analytics, as I'll get to in a minute, we sort of knew that we were gonna have to do a good deal of manual review there. So once you get to the point where you realize that you're gonna have to do a human review at some level, you have to make a choice of whether or not you want to divide and conquer or do it as a small team or individual. So the benefits of doing it as a team, obviously, are that it will get done faster, although it might get done faster at the cost of it being less consistent. The benefit of assigning it to an individual or a very small team is that it might be more consistent, and then the cost of that might be that it takes longer. So if you have a reasonable number of things you need to remap, then by all means, keep it to a small team or an individual. However, for our purposes, we've got thousands of active detection analytics. We've got 500 plus from atomic red team tests. And, like, I don't even know how many, but there's some, like, 200 plus attack technique and sub-technique combos. So that was just too much work for any individual to do. So we assembled a team consisting of our intelligence team, our threat research team, our detection engineering team, and most importantly, not me. So all credit goes to those three teams. I stood back and watched and asked a lot of questions and wrote a blog about it eventually. So I stole this quote from my colleague, Katie Nichols, but attack mapping is an art, it's not a science. So particularly if you're gonna have a team that's doing this work, you should create a style guide, because people interpret techniques in different ways. In a style guide, like the other thing to remember is that we're kind of learning this on the fly, right? Like these sub techniques are new. So a style guide will help us learn like how to map things. It will keep some guardrails on how we map, and it will help enforce consistency. Equally important is to assign a review team. So we assigned a team of senior detection engineers and intelligence analysts to review every single mapping decision that was made by the broader remapping team. This also helped to enforce consistency, and it helped us catch errors that we may have made in the mapping process. Lesson five, find and fix your legacy mapping issues. So I'm going to tell a little story. So when we were working on the threat detection report, like the first thing we do is we pull the data and we see, and we make a pivot table, and we see like, what are the top 10 MITRE attack techniques from last year? The initial data poll revealed that masquerading was the top technique. So we then went and we made a sub list of the detectors that converted to a threat that was mapped to masquerading most often. And these two detectors showed up. The first one looks for untrusted binaries spawning suspicious Windows service hosts. The second one identifies SVC host executing with a suspicious parent process. All told, these two detectors on their own or in conjunction with one another triggered on more than 4,000 confirmed threats. However, when my colleague and our principal intelligence analyst, Jeff Felling, went and reviewed all the individual detections associated with those two behavioral analytics, he made a startling discovery. He discovered that those two analytics actually were representative of process injection and not of masquerading. So we manually remapped them. We ran the numbers again. We also manually remapped a few other analytics, but they weren't nearly as dramatic as these ones. And process injection fell to number one, and then masquerading became number six. So this is a great lesson. Like, this is the perfect time to review your behavioral analytics. Also, probably good to be reviewing them on a continual basis just to make sure that nothing changes over time. Lesson number six, considering the alternatives. So I promised you that there was a third sort of why not both option for where we could do our attack mapping. And here's where I'm going to talk about that. So again, mapping at the detection level is the most accurate. Mapping at the analytic level is the fastest. However, we're developing an idea called conditional mapping. We haven't really operationalized it yet, but the idea is that we're going to try and identify ambiguous analytics. Maybe they're just broad. Maybe there's some sort of other problem going on. But the idea is, like, you pick out the ones that don't always alert on the thing you hypothesized they would alert on, and then you require a human review of those. So you're still able to keep the main benefit of mapping at the analytic level, because most of the mapping is going to get done there. So you still have the speed. And then you just identify that small subset of problematic detectors, and you require a human review of them. Now, the seventh and final lesson is just to have fun with it, guys. Just kidding. That's not the seventh lesson at all. The seventh lesson is actually, the lag's back, to give back to the MITRE ATT&CK community. So the ATT&CK team is constantly looking for feedback. They probably get less of it than they need. So ways you can give back. Obviously, the most obvious way to give back is probably to contribute techniques back to MITRE ATT&CK. But I think also, like, they want feedback on what's working and what's not working. And by all means, you should reach out to them and let them know, suggest improvements and whatever else you can think of. Finally, like, if you learn something while using ATT&CK that might be useful to the rest of us, write a blog about it or give a talk about it. And then while we're on the topic of blogs, I know that I only had 14 minutes here and I'm talking incredibly fast like a madman. So if you want to take more time with this talk, we wrote a blog version. Matt Graber and Katie Nichols and I wrote a blog version of this talk maybe a couple weeks ago. The link is right there. I'll try to remember to tweet it after this talk if any of you follow me on Twitter. And I guess without further ado, we can sort of jump into the Q&A.
That was fantastic, Brian. Thank you. That was really great. Like I said, I really appreciate coming from the attack side, we did so much work to kind of produce and publish these sub-techniques. So we are really excited to see like an organization as large as Red Canary adopt it and actually make it their own. Like you said, I love the quotes coming off that blog, the art of this, as well as all of the nuance. So definitely, I've seen a lot of traction and kind of activity going around about your talk. So definitely stay queued up for some questions. But one thing I just wanted to ask you was, you kind of mentioned how kind of artistic and free, kind of free spirited this mapping is. And one of the things I was wondering is, do you think that as advice to other organizations, is this an all or not effort, or can you map certain portions to sub techniques and then maybe stay behind in other areas? You mentioned how like nuanced Red Canary is with, you know, atomic red team and detections, as well as looking at the matrix itself. Like, do you think there's areas to carve that up, or do you think it's a binary yes or no kind of question?
Yeah. So I think that I'm interested in talking to other organizations about this, because I actually think that, like, in a weird way, Red Canary is like designed to be mapped to MITRE ATT&CK. And I think that there's a lot of people that would have a lot of a harder time with that. Like, specifically if you're doing like a lot of IOC and signature based stuff, I can see how it would be difficult to map things to ATT&CK. And also if like you're dealing with a lot of alerts that maybe are false positives, then I could also understand how that could be a problem. But yeah, for us, like the atomic red team stuff and the detection analytics really, really teed us up to have like a relatively easy job of mapping to ATT&CK.
Yeah, tracking. Thank you. And thanks again. Excellent talk. Like I said, I think the experience and wisdom that you guys have got kind of leading the way and doing that mapping is really greatly appreciated and, you know, big benefit to the community. So thank you. But with that, I think we're right on time to turn it over back to Adam for our introduction of our next speaker.
Great. Thanks so much.
Yeah, thank you both Jamie and Brian.